Today, we are going to be talking about three shapes: Sierpinski's triangle, the chaos game invented by Barnsley, and a colored version of Pascal's triangle. Each of these fractal-esque shapes are generated by processes that feel totally different, but as we'll soon see, there is some beautiful convergent behavior at play. Before that, however, let's properly introduce each of these shapes. Firstly, we have Sierpinski's triangle, a fractal built out of equilateral triangles. To create Sierpinski's triangle, start with a single equilateral triangle. Then punch out its middle to create three more triangles. Punch out the middle of these triangles to create nine triangles, and repeat. There's another way, which will be helpful later, to express this process. One again starts with an equilateral triangle, but now scales it down by two, and then slides two copies downward, one to the left and one to the right. Repeat this process with the new shape, scale down by two, send a copy to the left, send a copy to the right. As we iterate this process, the same sequence of shapes appears, stabilizing at Sierpinski's triangle. The next triangle is called the chaos game. Unlike Sierpinski's triangle, which was based on deterministic self-similarity, the chaos game, as the name suggests, is the product of random chance at every point in the process. To play the chaos game, one selects a point randomly inside an equilateral triangle. Then, we choose a random vertex and travel halfway to said vertex, leaving a dot where we visit. We repeat this random choice again and again and again until a picture begins to emerge. Finally, we have Pascal's triangle. To generate Pascal's triangle, we start with a dot containing a 1. Then we recursively generate each entry below it as the sum of the two elements, or in the case of elements on the edge, one element, above it. We also color each dot according to the number inside it: white if it contains an odd number, and black if it contains an even number. Pascal's triangle is also related to binomial coefficients. Recall that the binomial coefficient m choose n is the number of ways to choose n objects from a set of size m. For example, 5 choose 3 is 10, since there are 10 ways to choose 3 objects from a set of 5. As it turns out, the algorithm which we described for Pascal's triangle makes it a table of binomial coefficients in the following way. Now that you understand how each triangle works, let's watch the patterns emerge. Beautiful. Despite the three shapes appearing totally different in design, some are deterministic while others are probabilistic, some are continuous while others are discrete, some are geometric while others arithmetical, the result is the same shape in all three cases. Over the course of this video, we're going to follow an argument to discover an underlying property shared by all three of these triangles, a property that determines their final form. In doing so, we don't just create a novel proof for this convergence, but find out why it exists. Because these shapes are generated in such different ways, our journey will borrow ideas from a plethora of different fields, but I promise, with none of the terminology. My hope is to demonstrate what I think makes math exciting, the connections you never see coming. In that spirit, the only prerequisites for this video are grade school math, a sense of whimsy, and a little free time. Once you've got that, we're ready to begin. The next step is to decide on a coordinate system. We want a system that plays well with equilateral triangles and Pascal's triangle. Our first impulse might be to select the familiar Cartesian plane, but this doesn't work. The height of an equilateral triangle with side length 2 is the ugly square root of 3. Switching to polar coordinates seems promising. If we scale our triangle in the right way, all of the vertices of our triangle are easily expressed using polar coordinates. Even the midpoint of each side is simple, but these are the only points in the boundary which can be expressed simply. Trying to find any other point becomes a mess of trigonometry. It's not much of a surprise that these aren't the best options. Cartesian coordinates, in some sense, were built to work well with rectangles, and polar coordinates seem tailor-fit for circles. Is there a coordinate system designed for triangles? Barymetric coordinates offer such a thing. With barymetric coordinates, a point is described as the weighted sum of the displacement vectors corresponding to each vertex of the triangle. For example, the point 1 quarter, 1 quarter, 1 half in barymetric coordinates corresponds to the following point. As you might expect, barymetric coordinates easily describe almost any point we care about on an equilateral triangle. The vertices, the midpoints, all of the elements on the boundary, all of these are easily representable with barymetric coordinates. However, Pascal's triangle stumps barymetric coordinates. In this case, the center of Pascal's triangle is shifting as we add more rows, so the barymetric coordinates of each dot depends on how many rows we've drawn of Pascal's triangle. Plus, trying to figure out which dot any point in barymetric coordinates lies in is not fun. And what about the many coordinates that fall in between the dots? Where do they belong? We need a new coordinate system. This coordinate system should put the origin at the top of Pascal's triangle, since we build Pascal's triangle from the top down. At the same time, it should retain some ideas from barymetric coordinates, since they work so well with equilateral triangles. This compromise gives us the idea for what I call waterfall coordinates. Following is an illustration describing how waterfall coordinates work. As you can see, the waterfall coordinate MN is given by starting at the top, moving parallel to the left side m units, and then moving parallel to the right side n units. Waterfall coordinates also work well with Pascal's triangle, as you can see. In fact, they have a very simple relationship with binomial coefficients. Pause and ponder for a moment to make sure this relationship makes sense to you. This might seem like a small detail to dedicate a full section to, but I promise, taking the time to figure out a formulation of our space that respects the symmetry of the objects involved is well worth it. Now, let's move on to something even more fundamental: how we write numbers. Then, we'll be ready to start the proof proper. Usually, we write numbers in decimal notation, also called base 10. Under decimal notation, each place value corresponds to a power of 10, and the number is expressed as a weighted sum of powers of 10. Why 10? We have 10 fingers, so counting to 10 is a process we humans can actualize very easily. After all, digit is a synonym for finger. But math doesn't care how many fingers we have. Is there a better number system we could use, one built on numbers that play a key role in our problem? The answer is yes. Binary notation is better suited to answering questions about our three triangles. Binary, or base 2 notation, is based on powers of 2 instead of powers of 10. Again, each place value corresponds to a power of 2, and the number itself is expressed as a weighted sum of powers of 2, but instead of using the 10 digits 0 through 9, we only need the 2 digits 0 and 1. But why is binary notation better for our purposes? The simple answer is that 2 is at the heart of all of the operations we're interested in. For example, to create Sierpinski's triangle, we scale our triangle down by 2, which is the same as dividing each waterfall coordinate by 2. For Barnsley's triangle, we head halfway, that is, 1 over 2 of the way, to our chosen vertex. Pascal's triangle is colored based on whether or not numbers are divisible by 2. More subtly, Pascal's triangle seems to complete the pattern whenever the number of rows is a power of 2. Take a look. All of these operations are very simple in binary. Just as dividing by 10 is as simple as shifting the point in decimal notation, dividing by 2 in binary notation just amounts to moving the point one place to the left. Determining whether or not a number is divisible by 2 is even easier. Just look at the last digit. If it's a 0, the binary number is even, and if it's a 1, the binary number is odd. Finally, writing down the powers of 2 is super easy in binary, just like writing down powers of 10 is super easy in decimal notation. For all of these reasons, we suspect that binary, base 2, is the best language with which to attack this problem. And, as we'll see over the course of this video, we were totally correct. Let's begin with Sierpinski's triangle. Our goal is to take our notion of binary waterfall coordinates and transform that into an understanding of Sierpinski's triangle. To do this, we'll want to come up with a rule that can take a point written in binary waterfall coordinates and decide whether or not that point is contained in Sierpinski's triangle. Firstly, consider how we may decide whether or not a point is in the starting equilateral triangle. If m and n are non-negative, then the only issue is if we travel too far down the equilateral triangle. This happens precisely when m plus n is strictly greater than the side length of the triangle. For convenience, let's say that the side length of the triangle is 1, so the point mn is outside of the equilateral triangle precisely when m plus n is greater than 1. For example, the point 0.1, 0.1, recall that we're using binary notation where 0.1 equals 1/2, fits inside the equilateral triangle. Similarly, 0.01, 0.11, as well as 0.01, 0.101, all fit inside the equilateral triangle. However, 0.11, 0.1 does not. Notice that all of the coordinates of each of these points have a 0 before the decimal point. Well, I suppose that now we're working in base 2 instead of base 10, it's not a decimal point anymore, but a binary point. In any case, there are two points which don't follow this rule, the bottom vertices 10 and 01. For our purposes, we'll throw these two points out. Since there are infinitely many points all packed up against one another, it doesn't change the appearance of the triangle at all to ignore these two points. Now, what about stage 2 of the Sierpinski triangle? This shape composed of three triangles. Well, the top triangle is just a normal equilateral triangle scaled down by 2. Scaling down by 2 is the same as dividing each waterfall coordinate by 2, and dividing any binary number by 2 is the same as moving the binary point one spot to the left. Therefore, the points in this mini equilateral triangle can be described as having a 0 in both coordinates in the first binary place, and then the sum of the rest has to be less than the side length of the triangle, which is now 1/2. What about the points in the equilateral triangle to the left? Well, these are the same points as above, but we travel parallel to the left side halfway down the length of the full triangle. That is, we add 0.1 to the first coordinate. Therefore, the points of this mini equilateral triangle can be described as having a 1 and a 0 in the first binary place, and then the sum of the rest is less than 1/2. Analogously, the points in the equilateral triangle to the right are those with a 0 and a 1 in the first binary place, and then the sum of the rest is less than 1/2. So, if we combine all three mini equilateral triangles, we have the following rule. We always require that everything after the first binary place has sum at most 1/2, and then for the first binary place, we allow the combination 0, 0, 10, and 01. Succinctly, we require that the first binary place does not have two ones. It turns out that this process continues. For this shape, we can describe the points as those with no two ones in any of the first two columns after the binary point. Then the rest must have sum at most 1/4. For this shape, we can describe the points as those with no two ones in any of the first three columns after the binary point, and then the rest has sum at most 1/8. The pattern continues because at each stage, we're simply taking the previously allowed points and either inserting 0, 0 for the top triangle, 1, 0 for the left triangle, or 0, 1 for the right triangle in the first binary place. Now, what happens at Sierpinski's triangle, which arises as the limit of all of these iterations? Well, at the nth stage, we cannot have two ones in any of the first n columns after the binary point. Since Sierpinski's triangle comes after all of these partial stages, in some limiting sense, in Sierpinski's triangle, we are simply not allowed to ever have two ones in the same column. In conclusion, the points that are in Sierpinski's triangle, which arises as the limit of all of the partial stages, are precisely those points that never have two ones in the same column when written in binary waterfall coordinates. This rule is beautiful and exciting precisely because it's so simple, so easy to check. Now let's take a look at the chaos game. We start with some point whose exact coordinates I claim will matter very little after just a few iterations. Wherever we began, there are three directions we may head, each with equal probability. Halfway to the vertex at the top, halfway to the bottom left vertex, and halfway to the bottom right vertex. How do each of these transformations change the waterfall coordinates of our point? Notice that sending our point halfway to any given vertex can be understood as taking the average of the coordinates of our point and the coordinates of the given vertex, that is, taking their sum and dividing by 2. How can we understand this operation in binary waterfall coordinates? When we move towards the top vertex, which is coordinates 0, 0, we simply divide the coordinates by 2, which is equivalent to moving the binary point over one space to the left. Yet notice that unless our point has the exact coordinates 1, 0 or 0, 1, this is simply equivalent to inserting 0, 0 in the first binary place of our point's coordinates. Similarly, heading halfway towards the bottom left vertex is equivalent to sliding in 1, 0, and heading to the bottom right vertex is equivalent to sliding in 0, 1. As we iterate the process, the part that we started with becomes smaller and smaller, eventually negligible. What matters is that the process guarantees that after n iterations, the first n columns satisfy our no two ones rule, because each column inserted is either 0, 0, 1, 0, or 0, 1. This doesn't mean that we're exactly in Sierpinski's triangle, but it does mean that we get very, very close, infinitesimally close. But this isn't enough. Sure, it's good to know that all of the points of our chaos game eventually get infinitesimally close to Sierpinski's triangle, but perhaps they only get close to some of the points of Sierpinski's triangle, and neglect all the other ones. How do we know this doesn't happen? It turns out that the points of our chaos game get as close as we want to every point of Sierpinski's triangle, with probability 100%. How can we see this fact? Firstly, we have to discuss a particularly confusing nuance, the difference between happens with 100% probability and certain. In familiar settings, these two are the same. The idea that something happening 100% of the time doesn't mean that it always happens is strange. However, these concepts are different, and here's an example to show why. Suppose we keep rolling a die until we get a 6. Now, it is theoretically possible that we keep on rolling this die infinitely many times, always getting 1 through 5, but the probability that this will happen is precisely 0. It's 5 over 6 times 5 over 6 times 5 over 6 times 5 over 6, which tails off to exactly 0. If you're familiar with infinite products, you can show this rigorously, and you know that this product is not close to 0, it doesn't approach 0, it is exactly 0. The point is that given infinite chances, any event with non-zero probability is going to happen 100% of the time. Returning to the chaos game, it's possible for us to choose the top vertex forever, avoiding forming Sierpinski's triangle. But in practice, this won't happen. You see, to get very close to any given point of Sierpinski's triangle, all I need to do is make a sufficient number, say n, of the leading bits of the coordinates of our point and the point of Sierpinski's triangle match. To make this happen, all I need to do is choose the right way to slip in combinations of 0, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 0 to the binary waterfall coordinates of our point. In other words, all I need to do is choose the right sequence of n vertices for our point to head towards. Now, there are 3 to the n ways to choose a sequence of n vertices, and only one sequence that works. But that's still a non-zero probability of choosing the right sequence. Therefore, given infinitely many chances, I will get those n bits right with probability 1. Whether n is 3, and we're just in the ballpark, or n is a million, and a picture of Sierpinski's triangle with high enough resolution to tell them apart wouldn't fit in the known universe. Let's split the difference between 3 and a million, and consider the case of n equals 10, which is within a pixel on standard HD video. How does the probability of our matching the first 10 bits change after one iteration? 10 iterations? 100 iterations? 10,000 iterations? And finally, a million iterations? As we see, it soon approaches 100%, and in the limit, it is 100%. Let's look at an example. Our goal is to get to the green point, which belongs to Sierpinski's triangle. I'm going to play the chaos game, listing off the coordinates of the points that we visit, and count how many bits match up with the coordinates of the green point. As you can see, though we are often not close at all, there are those rare moments where we get close. Here, we're almost on top of the other point, after less than 100 iterations. As we keep iterating, we'll get attempts that are closer and closer to this point, as our number of attempts heads off to infinity. In conclusion, though the points of the chaos game might not perfectly match up with the points of Sierpinski's triangle, the following two ideas hold, which make it good enough. Firstly, every point of the chaos game is eventually arbitrarily close to a point of Sierpinski's triangle. And secondly, every point of Sierpinski's triangle is eventually arbitrarily close to a point of the chaos game, with probability 1. In math, we say that the chaos game is a random dynamical system, and the special role that Sierpinski's triangle holds in the system is that it is an attractor of the system. Because Sierpinski's triangle is also a fractal, the technical term is a strange attractor of the system. And it really is strange. The fact that such a uniformly random system would have an attractor with so much structure, in fact, infinite structure, is very surprising. But we don't have time to dwell on this fact. It's time to move on to Pascal's triangle. Since it's been a while, let's remind ourselves how we created our colored Pascal's triangle. Firstly, we defined Pascal's triangle proper using an addition rule, and then we colored each dot white if it contained an odd number, and black if it contained an even number. We also found that Pascal's triangle was a table of binomial coefficients, and noted that the structure of this table is expressed very simply using waterfall coordinates. Just like in Chapter 3, our goal is to find a rule that will tell us, in terms of the binary waterfall coordinates of a dot, whether that dot will be colored white or black. Already, we can imagine what this rule will be. No two ones in the same column, just as with our previous two shapes. However, to prove this rule, we'll need to work through a good deal of math, including introducing an idea called the two-adic valuation. Intuitively, the two-adic valuation measures how divisible by 2 any given number is. Formally, the definition of the two-adic valuation of n is the largest integer k, such that 2 raised to the kth power divides n. Let's look at some examples. Firstly, the two-adic valuation of 2 is 1, since 2 to the first power divides 2, but 2 squared does not. On the other hand, the two-adic valuation of 4 is 2, since 2 squared divides 2, but 2 cubed does not. Similar reasoning holds for the other integers displayed. Notice that the two-adic valuation of a number is 0 if and only if that number is an odd integer. Make sure you understand why this holds before moving on. There are many formulae involving the two-adic valuation, but I want to start with the two most basic rules: how the valuation interacts with multiplication and division. Simply put, the valuation of m times n is the sum of the valuation of m and the valuation of n. For example, the valuation of 48 is the sum of the valuations of 6 and 8. A similar rule holds for division. To discover it, notice that by the multiplication rule, we have the following formula. This could then be rearranged into a rule for division. Critically, this equation implies that m divided by n is odd if and only if the two-adic valuation of m is equal to the two-adic valuation of n. Now that we understand the two-adic valuation, let us return our attention to Pascal's triangle. To understand which entries of Pascal's triangle are colored white, we need to find which entries of Pascal's triangle have two-adic valuation of 0. Recalling that the waterfall coordinate mn is labeled with m plus n choose m, and our rules about multiplication and division, we simplify this task. Notice that we can totally evaluate the right-hand side of the final expression as long as we have a formula for the two-adic valuation of k factorial. With such a general formula, we can plug it in here, here, and here to test the equation. Therefore, let's try to evaluate the two-adic valuation of k factorial directly using the multiplication rule we discussed earlier. The resulting sum clearly has a pattern, 0, 1, 0, 2, 0, 1, 0, 3, etc. But what we're essentially doing is adding 1 for each multiple of 2 up to k, then adding an additional 1 for each multiple of 4 up to k, then adding an additional 1 for each multiple of 8 up to k, and so on. In other words, the 2-adic valuation of k factorial is the number of multiples of 2 less than k, plus the number of multiples of 4 less than k, plus the number of multiples of 8 less than k, and so on. This is called Legendre's formula, and we can instantly see that it will be especially elegant in binary, where dividing by 2 amounts to simply shifting bits. In fact, when we write k in binary, Legendre's formula becomes extremely simple. From here, we have an actual shot at evaluating the result. First, we notice that we can rearrange the bits, just like how in decimal notation, 17 plus 23 is the same as 13 plus 27. In binary, swapping two bits in the same place does not change a sum's result. Therefore, this sum is the same as this rearranged sum, where we've grouped together like bits. But, of course, in each of these terms, we can factor out the repeated bit, leaving a string of ones. Yet strings of ones in binary are just like strings of nines in decimal notation. Adding one makes them a clean power of the base. This allows us to express our strings of 1s as a power of 2 minus 1. Distributing each ki, we are left with the following sum, which reduces to this expression, k minus each of its individual bits. Another way to express subtracting each of the individual bits of k is to say that we subtract the total number of 1s in the binary expansion of k. Let's denote this quantity, which in either case is subtracted from k, by w of k. Now let us return to the central question. When is the valuation of m plus n factorial equal to the valuation of m factorial plus the valuation of n factorial? Plugging in our expression and simplifying, we find that this happens precisely when w of m plus n equals w of m plus w of n. That is, the number of 1s in the binary expansion of m plus n is the same as the number of 1s in the binary expansion of m plus the number of 1s in the binary expansion of n. Now, if m and n never have two 1s in the same column, then this plainly holds. On the other hand, if they ever do have two 1s in the same column, then these two 1s will cancel each other out to produce a 0, only moving a single 1 over into the next column via carrying. There's no way to make up this missing 1, so if m and n ever have two 1s in the same column, this formula fails. At this point, the conclusion is clear via a chain of equivalences. Any dot is colored white if and only if its binary waterfall coordinates never have two 1s in the same column. And so we find that the no two 1s rule governs this shape too, as absurd as it might have seemed when we began this proof. And so we find that the same rule governs all three shapes. A point belongs to any one of our triangles precisely if, when expressed in binary waterfall coordinates, there are never two ones in any single column. Not only does this serve as a proof that all three of these shapes are the same at the limit, it helps us understand what's really going on. The same process of selecting particular binary waterfall coordinates masked behind three different types of math. Transformations in the case of the Sierpinski triangle, randomness in the case of the chaos game, and combinatorics and number theory in the case of our colored Pascal's triangle. Ostensibly, this is a video about three triangles. But I'd like to suggest that it was about more than that. It was about the fascinating interdisciplinary nature of math, about connections that feel like cosmic coincidences until we dig into them and find out they're as natural as the sky being blue.
I'd like to return to Poincaré's quote. Mathematics is the art of giving different things the same name. Poincaré clearly understood the power of interdisciplinary connection. After all, he's often called by mathematicians the last man to know all of math. But I'd still like to suggest that his quote is a little bit wrong. Because to say that we give mathematical objects the same name is to give ourselves too much credit. Because math fundamentally is a process of discovery. Now, this is not to say that we didn't invent math. Certainly, we have chosen our axioms and defined our logic system. But just as the makers of chess could not foresee Fischer versus Spassky or Kasparov versus Topalov, the beautiful and intricate structure that we described continues to inspire and surprise us. When I sat down to make this video, I did so out of a sense of curiosity and dissatisfaction. I had never really understood why these three triangles exhibited this type of convergent behavior, and no source that I could find online explained it to me in a way that resonated with me. In a sense, deciding to start this project was a gamble that I could force myself to solve this problem before summer ended. It's a gamble that every mathematician has to make every time they sit down to look at a problem. You just don't get to see when that gamble fails. And so, over the course of your mathematical journey, if you ever find yourself rolling snake eyes a couple times in a row, I hope you won't think that you just don't have what it takes to do math. Because none of us can sit down and choose to create math. We can only get up, wander out into a world of our own creation, and hope that we happen upon it. Thank you for watching, and thank you for your support.